Welcome to BACC Sunday Livestream with your host, Russ Yule. We have some sweet sounds brought to you by Freedom Flows, along with a few stories in store for you on lives that have been changed. Visit bacc.cc/live for service resources and downloadable PDFs of Simple Notes and Doodle Notes.
Hey kids, it's Roos from Zootopia. I need your help. During the live stream, please keep an eye out for my friends Judy, Nick, and Chief Boggle. You can have your parents print the drawing sheet to help you. Thank you, kids!
If you want to get connected with people in your area, text BACC to 31996 and someone will reach out to you. When you like our videos, you help us grow in who we are able to reach. So put down your Cinnabon for a second to like our video on the BACC YouTube channel. If you haven't already, make sure to subscribe to our channel as well. As a reminder, we have a socially distant drive-in movie night on August 22nd. To purchase your tickets, visit bacc.cc/drive-in. Here's a special word on that.
Totally rad song. Reminds me of summer nights at the drive-in.
We were really something back then.
Now that's my jam. Takes me back.
Oh, snap.
Hold up. Let's fast forward to 2020. We're excited to go to the drive-in for the first time.
We can't wait to get out of the house and see Wonder and Karate Kid on a huge screen. We will be safe, socially distanced, and we must have snacks.
If you haven't registered, there are a few spots left. Go to bacc.cc. The first movie starts at 8:30, Westwind Drive-In, 3630, Hillcap Avenue, San Jose. See you there!
Good morning, and make sure that if you want to go to the drive-in, you do register because it's overflowing, and I think it's going to be a great time. Shout out to Phoenix Collette, who edited the drive-in theater section and that whole little very humorous depiction of the past and the present, which we all like to be able to touch on both. Today is the story episode of our live stream, How to Change a Life. The story episode is important. Matthew 13:34 says, Jesus used stories to tell all these things to the people. He always used stories to teach them. That's why we're having a story episode, in order to help us all understand what it means to change a life and to see a life changed. We hope that you're watching the live stream to be inspired, to be encouraged, to feel connected, but ultimately to allow God to move in your life, to help you, to help me, to help us change in ways that allow our dreams to come true and our destiny to be fulfilled, which is not only to have an abundantly flourishing life of our own, but to make the lives of those around us better. And this is something never more needed than now. Mary Catherine Bateson, you may know her mom, Margaret Mead. That's right, Margaret Mead, one of the greatest anthropologists in the history of this country. And cultural anthropologist Mary Catherine Bateson is her daughter. And she writes, the human species thinks in metaphors and learn through stories. Oftentimes, we get our messages best through stories. That's why we like movies. That's why we like country music. That's why we like love ballads, because they tell stories. It's why we like comic books. It's why we like Harry Potter, because they tell stories. And sometimes even the most confusing things come clean and true to us as stories. Who would have ever thought that a movie about math would become one of the most favorited movies in the history of filmmaking, Good Will Hunting? Maybe you missed that it was about math, but it's 100% about math, but because it's a story, we remember the story and not the math. Again, Mary Catherine Bateson writes, we are not what we know, but what we are willing to learn. So often, we can build our lives on what we know and not understand that the most significant part of our lives is what we're willing to learn. That's how we continue to grow, whether we're 5, 50, 70, 80, 100. We keep growing because we continue to want to learn. This is true whether we're talking about work and business, whether we're talking about building a family, being friends, having conversations, or studying the Bible as we do today. It's a willingness to learn. What can happen is once we finish high school, or in some cases, middle school, we can shut off the learning instinct. We can decide we don't want to learn. But it's important for us to remember that learning, as Mrs. Bateson says, learning is what our life is all about. It is the sum of our life. And so in telling stories today, we're not going to have me feature and talk as much. We're going to have the stories do the talking. How to change a life. And that begins with a question because we want to learn. Psalm 119:59 says, I pondered the direction of my life and I turn to follow your laws. Today, what we want to encourage you to do is ponder the direction of your life. Every day we really should do that to stay hungry, to keep learning, to keep growing. Proverbs 5:6, she doesn't give any thought to her way of life. Her paths have no direction, but she doesn't realize it. It's talking there about a woman who, just like men, it just because it says she doesn't mean it's only for women, it's for men too, is that she was living a reckless life, and the reason she was living a reckless life is she didn't give any thought to her life. She had no direction. This morning, what we want to do is ask ourselves a question, not am I in college studying for a degree, not do I have a job, not am I making money, not can I pay my mortgage or afford insurance. Those are all important questions, and in the case of things like insurance, an essential question. But at the end of the day, even when we amass all those things, if our life has no direction, we're going to be tormented inside. We're going to feel lost. Proverbs 20:24, Good News Translation, the Lord has determined our path. How then can anyone understand the direction his own life is taking? Well, that's not saying that God controls you. That's saying that God created you and me. And that we've been given a destiny. We've been given a path. We've been given talents. We've been given things to do. Our interests, our desires are all funneled in the direction of making not only our life fulfilled, but being able to make the lives of others fulfilled. In Proverbs 6:23, for their direction is a lamp. It's talking about the Bible. For their direction is a lamp. Their instruction will light your path, and their discipline will correct your missteps, sending you down the right path of life. Very briefly, what do we learn here? Illumination. We're going to look at a quote from Ralph Waldo Emerson later, and he talks about illumination. It'll be at the end, so you can savor the potentiality of that. Now, you can also savor your Cinnabon. You know what I'm thinking about? Is that a Cinnabon in some ways is a lamp, isn't it? It's a lamp to a delightful feeling while you listen to the live stream. I've been encouraged greatly by many of you who sent me pictures of Cinnabons. In particular, I enjoyed the one that was dropped off at one of the sisters' house, and it had a little note on it. And it was a picture of the Cinnabon, and it said, wait for Russ's signal to be able to eat. Now, I know that some of you don't wait for the signal. You eat, and that's good. Why listen to a man? But I thought it was pretty cool. I also thought it was pretty neat. I asked for permission. I forgot to check Facebook to see if I have permission, so I won't use any names. But one of my good friends sent me a message yesterday on Facebook Messenger, and he said, essentially, and I paraphrase to add a little bit of exaggerative excitement to the story. He said, I can't believe what I just heard come out of my son's mouth while playing with his toys. He said, and he gave me a quote, and if you do that, then you can have your Cinnabon. It's amazing that even the little kids are listening and what they're listening to. Somebody get a hold of Cinnabon and tell them they need to be sponsoring this live stream. Oh, that's right. We make our own, don't we? Kimmy Traver made me for my birthday. It was a little bit ago, and I'm not asking for any gifts at all. I'm just telling you what happened. And the Travers and our family are very close. Like family, as many of you are that way. She made me for my birthday homemade gluten-free Cinnabons. I've totally gotten distracted, haven't I? Proverbs 6:23. For their direction is a lamp, their instruction will light your path, and their discipline will correct your missteps, sending you down the right path of life. What does that tell you? Okay, if you're like me, and this is one of the first times you've really engaged with religion or church, then you're resistant to the idea of rules. And this passage is really good, because what it says is, the Bible's not a set of rules. The Bible is a light for your path, to give you direction, and when you get off your path, it corrects your missteps. Sin is not about your less. Sin is not about your moral failure. Sin is not about you are a terrible person. It's about you and I have gotten off our path, and we get back on our path by following the Word of God. And so we ask the question, what is your life? Just like it asks in James chapter 4, what is your life? And so as we look at this, that's what we're trying to understand. What is your life, or what are your true colors? Now you know that's a segue for a freedom flow. Enjoy it.
You with the sad eyes, don't be discouraged, no, I realize it's hard to take courage.
How to change a life. That's our theme for today. How to change a life. How to find your true colors and how to help others find their true colors. How do we do it? We tell the story of God. That's the story we're going to focus on today, because when we tell stories, just like a dad telling stories to his daughter's friend, it changes lives. And so often we tell the rules. So often we tell the location, where to meet, where to go, what we need to do, but we don't tell the story. And the story is what has to be told. In Mark chapter 1, in verse 4, John the Baptizer appeared in the wild, preaching a baptism of life change that leads to forgiveness of sins. People thronged to him from Judea and Jerusalem, and as they confessed their sins, were baptized by him in the Jordan River into a changed life. John wore a camel hair habit, tied at the waist with a leather belt. He ate locusts and wild field honey. All right? So this guy was vegan. All right? That's what we know. Here's the thing with John the Baptizer. He told a story of God, that God was going to forgive sins. And as a result, people told their sins and said, hey, we want to be free of these sins. And then baptism was the way that they got free. They set themselves free from those sins. And when that happened, it resulted in a changed life. The story of God is replacing pain with courage. The pain of failure, hurt, sin, the pain of disillusionment, discouragement, the pain of suffering from the result of bad choices by others or by ourselves, all of that's wiped away, and God replaces that pain with the courage to live our true colors. And what better story to point that out as a story of the week from Silicon Valley North. Take a look.
I'm Scott Colvin, and my wife Margo and I love leading the Silicon Valley North part of our church. This story shows just how much is possible when we have courage and we really care. Bob, Victoria, and Ruben Moss have been neighbors with the Hessfelds for about 8 years now. Over the years, their friendship has grown through the Mosses hosting cookouts and parties and s'mores nights. But one night, their courage and their care was put to the test.
Bob heard someone outside in his neighbor's yard. He could have looked away, but he decided to get involved. He went outside to discover a man breaking into his neighbor's house and threatening their life. Bob courageously intervened, and consequently, the man turned on Bob. Victoria immediately called the police, but it was taking too long for them to arrive. She decided to call her neighbor, Dave Hessfeld. Dave is a seventh-degree black belt in Cook Sewell who runs his own studio. At great personal risk, but without hesitation, Dave came out and helped Bob subdue the man until the police arrived.
We didn't have a really close relationship in the beginning, but I realized that since they were asking for help, that, you know, this would be an opportunity to show that, you know, I can care for my neighbors too.
Then Bob and Dave both helped the police officers, as one of the officers was injured. As a result of their courage and care, the police and the city council awarded both Bob and Dave citizenship awards, honored them at a police banquet, and threw a pizza party for them at their neighborhood. From that moment on, the Mosses and Hessfelds shared a special bond, and their friendship was solidified. However, there's still more to the story, because having courage and care means that you get involved in all areas of life.
I remember the next day going on a walk and praying and saying, God, these guys saved my husband's life. What will it take for us to reach out to them and help save their souls?
The Mosses invited the Hessfelds to the fall marriage retreat, where they received so much help, they decided to study the Bible. And just a year ago, both Dave and Yulin Hessfeld were baptized. Now, the Hessfelds and Mosses are the leaders and the glue that brings their neighborhood together. They regularly co-host bonfire and movie nights. Even during the pandemic, they have hosted social distance gatherings to bring their neighborhood together.
Convictions that Victoria and I have always had is that wherever we have lived, we always believe God has put us there to reach out to our neighbors. You know, through all this experience, though, even though it was very negative and pretty traumatic, I feel like God was able to turn something like that into something, you know, very powerful.
I'm inspired by my own studies and the studies that I've seen my wife go through, and just the whole process. I want to be part of that. Whether it's a neighbor or a friend of a friend or anybody, I want to become part of this great process of bringing people into the kingdom.
This story inspires me that so much is possible when we have courage and we really care. If you have a story to share, please send it to live@bacc.cc.
That story, instant classic. We will see that again. I could watch that all day long. Peace, Dave. The story of God is Jesus, not religiosity. In Mark 1, verse 7, as he preached, he said, "The real action comes next." This is John the Baptist preaching. "The real action comes next. The star in this drama, to whom I'm a mere stagehand, will change your life. I'm baptizing you here in the river, turning your old life in for a kingdom life." His baptism, a holy baptism by the Holy Spirit, will change you from the inside out. If you want to know more about that, get a hold of a friend and ask them, explain the difference between those two baptisms. That'll be a real cool study. You'll love that. But it's about Jesus, not religiosity, meaning ministers, music, live streams, they're not the star. Jesus is the star. Being able to call ourselves a Christian, being able to attend services, being able to act Christian, in quotes, that's not it. Jesus is the star. And when Jesus is the star, people's lives change in dramatic ways. Let's take a look at this story of the week from Contra Costa. Enjoy.
I'm Jason Collette, and I have the privilege to lead the Contra Costa South Sector with my wife, Michelle. I'm excited to share a story about how the Bible can radically change someone's life and relationships. Darren Jordanik experienced a transformation from someone who lived in isolation and fear of relapse to a person whose courage and love inspires others to change. Darren started using drugs and alcohol at age 14 and continued until he was 23 years old. His family flew down from Virginia to California for an intervention and helped him go to rehabilitation.
I had stopped using drugs before I studied the Bible, and I think there was a lot of love and support from my family that prompted that. But I think what I found was that I had changed a lot of my behaviors, but now instead of, you know, a substance sort of making me feel a certain way, now it was like, hey, if I'm just safe and protected from any harm, that's enough, you know. But I was still this 16-year-old kid or 15-year-old kid emotionally inside because I hadn't developed.
He was very lonely, living alone in an apartment and just going to work and AA meetings. While he was working at Starbucks, Darren noticed someone reading a Bible, and he asked if he could read it. Darren came with him to church, and he liked the realness of the people and decided to get involved in small group Bible studies. Darren found the Bible to be truthful and liberating, as it gave him a standard to live his life by.
I was more inspired to love people than I was afraid to be rejected, because I knew that ultimately, you know, how I was identified by God, not by my own fears. And, you know, there was a lot of people that led the way in showing how that was done.
The Bible radically changed his heart from hardened and bitter to soft and caring. The Bible helped him to have the courage to be honest and vulnerable so that he could build close relationships with his parents, siblings, and friends.
I used to think, obviously, that, hey, I'll find fulfillment taking care of me, but like that just left me empty, right? So I find now that serving and loving other people is actually the thing that fulfills me, whether or not what I think I need happens or not, you know? So I see it both being that overflow of gratitude, and there's so much more to gain out of serving and loving others.
Darren is now married to his wife, Jen. They have two young sons. He helps to lead an inclusive soccer program and a small group of families in Bible studies and community involvement. His change is now inspiring others to change their lives as well.
Boy, oh boy, oh boy. Are these, Darren, when the movie's made, I'm going to watch it. What a story. These are the stories of God. These are not what some human being did. These are things God did. And if you're sitting there and you're thinking, man, I could use a life change like that, you know, you can have that change. God does more than get us to go to church. He totally transforms our lives. The story of God is about relationship, not performance. It's about him wanting a relationship. Now, that was really hard for me to understand and grasp the spiritual world, to understand and grasp that there are things we do not see and there are things we cannot touch that dominate and influence this world greater than anything we see or touch. And that God is sovereign, that means he's over all that. And that God, who is enormous, without limit of power, without limit of knowledge, who has infinite understanding. When we're laying on our bed at night and we feel like no one understands me, no one cares about me, that is only because we choose not to turn to God and speak to God in the silence of our darkness and say, God, I need help. I don't want to be alone anymore. I want to know my way. I want to find my direction. And instead of getting involved in the pursuit of pleasure, get involved in the pursuit of relationship. Instead of getting involved in the pursuit of pleasure, get involved in the pursuit of purpose. Try to get a whole life instead of a fraction of a life. Remember integers in math when you're in high school or in middle school? Remember integers? Remember integrity? That's not about performance. That's about building a whole life. And the story of God, that's about building a whole life. It's about relationship, not performance. Psalm 32, verse 8, I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. Look at that. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. God doesn't hate us. Remember Lethal Weapon? When Mel Gibson and Danny Glover are in the car. And Danny Glover goes, you know what? God gave me you, Mel Gibson, as a partner. God must hate me. And then Mel Gibson turned to Danny Glover and said, hate him back. It works for me. How many of us have a hateful thought, a hate-filled relationship with God because we have the wrong understanding? We've listened to the wrong people. Read the scriptures. Don't listen to people who don't know what they're talking about. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like the horse or the mule, which have no understanding, but must be controlled by bit and bridle, or they will not come to you. Many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in him. God doesn't want to control us. God wants to inspire us. God doesn't want to control us. God loves us. Let's take a look at this story of the week from San Francisco.
Hi, I'm Ray Kim, and my wife Amy and I lead the Great San Francisco Sector of the Church.
We want to tell you a story about how the courage to choose conviction over compromise restored hope and transformed an entire family.
Rodrigo and Erica were living together while expecting their second son. They weren't married yet and were having difficulty in their relationship. After Erica's brother lost his battle with meningitis, Erica and Rodrigo both decided to search for God and get help. Eventually, Rodrigo and Erica were invited to church by a friend, and both started studying the Bible. Yet as the Bible studies continued, Rodrigo decided he wasn't ready to change yet and stopped studying the Bible. A few months later, after their son was born, Rodrigo found himself still partying and drinking.
I wasn't content, I wasn't happy, and I wasn't fulfilled. New Year's came and went back to service, just to church, and started studying the Bible again, and then got convicted from there. And we started doing studies once a week, and then we started doing twice a week, and then we told them we wanted to do it every day until we got baptized.
They chose to have the courage to rebuild their relationship on the Bible, and decided to move out from each other to focus on building a relationship with God and to rebuild their relationship with each other before moving forward to get married.
It opened up my eyes like, wait, you're telling me that everything I've done, my mistakes, the bad decisions I've made, I can have a clean slate, I can have my sins forgiven, I can start over, I can, like, God will forgive me, like, have a pure dating relationship, which I've never experienced.
Despite being questioned and criticized by family members for their new convictions, they chose to have courage and continue to change and were baptized.
It convicted my dad to a point that my dad and my mom started studying the Bible. They got baptized. My brother-in-law that we used to party a lot, he kind of got convicted. He got baptized. You can see how God was working. My brother Andrew got baptized too. And my cousin Sarah got baptized. And life was awesome.
Later, in a tragic car accident, Rodrigo lost 5 of his close family members.
The church helped us out in a lot of ways, in support, and which we needed. It was a big ordeal for our family. If it wasn't for that, I definitely would not be here right now, for sure. seeing how God's family is united in that way.
Today, Rodrigo and Erica are passionate about changing lives and continue to help their friends study the Bible.
It's a way to give women hope and also work on myself as well. You know, it definitely goes both ways. It's a two-way street when you study the Bible with someone.
Both Rodrigo and Erica Wisano's sons, Matthew and Rodrigo Jr., studied the Bible and became disciples in San Francisco. Conviction requires courage, and when lived out, it transforms entire families and impacts future generations.
Rodrigo and Erica, you almost gave me an emotional breakdown. Oh my goodness. I knew some of that story. Goodness, what an incredible story. All right, we got a few more things to go on, but these things are killing me. Oh my goodness, are they killing you? Gosh, I need a Cinnabon. Is there one around here somewhere? Sheesh. I am so inspired, I don't know what to do with myself. The story of God is conviction, not behavior, but I don't need to say anything because you just saw it. 1 Thessalonians 1:4, for we know, brothers and sisters loved by God, that he has chosen you because our gospel came to you not simply with words, but also with power, with the Holy Spirit, and deep conviction. You know how he lived among you for your sake. Rodrigo and Erica just showed us. When going to church shouldn't be about placing membership. It should be about transforming life. It should be about getting a whole new ship. That's what it should be. Hey, let's take another look at the story. I just barely recovered from that story. Story of the week, Santa Clara. Enjoy it.
I'm Brianita, and my wife, Rosalind, and I have the incredible privilege of leading the great people of the Santa Clara part of our church. I want to tell you a story today of one of those great individuals. A story of how God can turn a heart of overwhelming doubt into a heart of unwavering care when we decide to rely on him and serve him rather than our fears. This is the story of Jake Walker, a young teen who matured from the baby of his family to leading and building family in his own home. Unlike many teens who want to study the Bible when they first enter high school, Jake was plagued with doubts about God, the Bible, and his own ability to be a spiritual person.
At that moment in time when I was like a freshman or sophomore in high school, like I never really let anyone else into like who I was.
However, Jake has always had a heart for his family. He started studying the Bible as a junior in hopes to learn how to help his family. By studying the Bible, Jake learned and developed the conviction that love is willing to serve and courageously play any role necessary to create family. A pivotal moment in his studies was when Jake courageously sat his parents down and shared the scriptures with his family to call them back to the Bible. Through studying the Bible, Jake matured from someone who has served to becoming a leader who is willing to serve. Jake became a Christian in his junior year of high school and continues to serve his family. As a teenager in our Y ministry, he helped his friend Alex to become a Christian. As a college student, Jake has led and built family in our young campus group. And throughout that time, he has served in the Y ministry, helping multiple teens to change their lives. Just recently, Jake has begun to lead our Y ministry in Santa Clara.
I've been such a changed person through all of it. Like, I want to be able to like, you know, give that opportunity to like somebody else to like experience like the love and just like the transformation that like I was able to have.
Jake's story is a story of how God can turn a heart of overwhelming doubt into a heart of unwavering care when we decide to rely on him and serve him rather than our fears.
Shout out to the Walker family. I know them. Jake, you're a little nothing running around when I last saw you. How did you, what? Stop. Shout out. I know your mom likes Bruce Springsteen and your dad is cool as the other side of the pillow for a show. All right. These stories. You know, the story of God is about outsiders, not insiders. You know, one of the worst things that can happen to a church is it can start being about itself instead of being about people who are not there. That's right. Somebody was sitting out there going, what, that means you want to convert the whole world? No, we want to change the world. We want to change the world. Convert? What does convert mean? Have you ever been to a foreign country? You know, another country, you go in, you got some dollars, you take it to the little bank teller there, and they convert your money into a different kind of money. I don't want to convert. I want the real thing. It's not about convergence, it's about change. I don't want them to give me some Deutschmarks for my dollars. They even make those anymore? Because the European Union, I don't even know what they use anymore. I haven't checked that out. Deutschmarks. I like the sound of that, Deutschmarks. No, I don't want an exchange. I don't want a conversion. I want a complete change. I know we call Christianity, you get converted, but that's not really, you don't get converted. You get eliminated and a new you comes into being. That's what those stories are telling me. And it's about outsiders. For a lot of us, we make the church all about us. Well, I want this kind of music. I want this kind of lighting. I want this kind of building. I want this kind of leader. I want the, what? No, 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 no. This ain't Burger King or McDonald's. It's about outsiders. People who aren't in. Acts 26:19. King Agrippa, I did not disobey the vision from heaven. The vision Paul received from heaven was to go to, well, let me finish reading the scripture instead of telling you. What am I doing? I began in Damascus, then continued in Jerusalem, then throughout the Judean countryside, then among the outsiders. Do you remember that book? I read that book in either middle school or high school. The Outsiders. You see the movie? I saw the movie. The Outsiders. Jesus was all about the outsiders. Christians should all be all about the outsiders, not condemning them, not looking down on them, not being self-righteous and going, why do those people do that? Why do those people act that way? But instead having incredible compassion and energy to serve, to love, to care, and to change lives. Then among the outsiders, telling everyone they must turn from their past and toward God and align their deeds and way of life with this new direction. Remember we talked about direction at the beginning? I'm not talking about that music group some of you millennials used to watch, please. They were good though, I enjoyed them. I'm talking about a new direction for your life. If you're sitting there right now and you're a little nervous and you're thinking, I'm very inspired right now by these stories. Well, you're not alone, number one. And number two, the next story, it could be yours. And I'm not just joking about that. The next story could be yours. Let's take a look at another story of the week, Silicon Valley South.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Straw, and my husband Nick and I are from the wonderful Silicon Valley South sector of our church. I have a story about how God truly determines the times and places so that we can find him. God led Mindy to the Bay Area in pursuit of an architectural firm job, but little did she know that he was actually leading her to a relationship with him.
After growing up in Canada and graduating college, Mindy applied to many jobs in the Toronto area, and on a whim, applied to a company in the Bay Area. God wanted her here. After accepting the job here, Mindy uprooted her life and moved to the Bay. After she moved, she felt the pang of loneliness that comes from living in a new country on your own. Knowing others who had a faith in God, she decided to give church a try. Through an internet search for local churches, she found our BACC website and came to our Palo Alto Sunday service. There, she met Christians and was inspired by their faith, and they became close friends. Mindy began studying the Bible. Shortly after, we were all sheltered in place, adding new challenges and opportunities to Mindy's studies.
She went after her relationship with God. She continued to study the Bible multiple times a week while sheltered in place. It was inspiring for me to see her wake up at 6 a.m. to go on prayer walks every day, to stay connected with all of us.
Some of the women would send her like boba every day, and they would pick someone different to send her favorite boba just to like encourage her.
She took the scriptures and went back and resolved them with God. Whenever she had a really hard time, whenever she had a difficult truth that she had to face, she always went back to the Bible.
Knowing that, like, hey, my purpose is supposed to be about helping people, knowing that, hey, even during this time, during shelter in place, every study was a step forward to helping someone. And that helped me to want to, like, continue to fight to give and not be selfish.
It gave me hope and, like, faith that I could study with anybody, anywhere. Anybody could be open and want a relationship with God, and that it just because you're not close by doesn't mean that that can't happen.
After some months of learning about God, who he is, and the love he has, and changing her life, Mindy was baptized on May 29th, 2020.
Wow, what an incredible story. You know, I got that whim. They said on a whim, Mindy applied for a job in the Bay Area from Toronto. You know what that is? It's the same way I ended up going to school in Boston. It wasn't on a whim, it was a plan, but God has a plan. But I was watching and I realized, Mindy, I met you. I was out praying. I went out praying one day and a car stopped near me and a young lady rolled down the window and I didn't know what. It was right in the middle of, I can't remember what was going on. I think the pandemic had just started. And I was like, you know, when someone stops, you don't know what's going on. And she introduced herself. Yeah, she was very nice. Mindy, you got great potential. Keep it going. Keep the fire burning. And what an incredible story. We thank you for that story, because that story tells us that we need to be thinking about the people around us, thinking about the amazing things that God is doing in their life. Sometimes we're so focused on our life and us being the star of the drama, we forget Jesus is the star of the drama. We're just the stage hands moving the props around. I know I hurt some of our feelings right there, but the reality is, it's the truth. It was the same with Larry Bird and Magic Johnson. There were other players on that team. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar gets a shout out. Kevin McHale gets a shout out. But let's face it, Magic and Larry, that's the story. Right there, Mindy's the story. What a story. And I love how they told the story through the people who knew her. Wasn't that cool? Wasn't that cool? You know what we've learned today? Something that Richard D. Richardson Jr. wrote about in The Mind on Fire. Awesome book about Ralph Waldo Emerson. Here's what he says. Emerson would go even further in his repudiation of conventional history to a belief that the great turning points in a life are not events, but moments of illumination. Think about that. Emerson questioned conventional history and said, look, I don't believe that the events are the story. The real story are the moments of illumination. Let me give you one and we'll move on. Franklin Delano Roosevelt, President of the United States during World War II and the Depression, one of the absolute four most important presidents and most effective presidents in the history of this country, bar none, no question. What was his moment of illumination? Polio. He was incredibly talented and did incredible things. I think he was the Assistant Secretary of Navy before that. But guess what? He got polio, and that made him the man he became, a man, though rich, capable of having empathy on, reaching out to and serving those who were poor. In fact, one of the things he was called by the wealthy, in so many words, a traitor to his class. That's another great book. Yeah, I read that one too. You'll enjoy it. And so what do we learn? Can today be a moment of illumination for us? A moment where instead of watching a live stream, we just say, I want to change my life. Meaning, not just say I watched it, but the reason I watched it was God is trying to change my life. We can do it. And remember what I was telling you, the next story could be yours. And there's no better time to meditate on that than communion. And here's another Better Together for you to help us set our minds for communion.
Hi, we are Scott and Margo Colden, and we have the privilege of leading the Silicon Valley North part of the church. We're so grateful during these times to have this live streams, Zoom, and bubble groups to bring us together with our friends here in Silicon Valley. Communion is one of those times to bring us together, to remember the freedom we can have because Jesus resurrected from the dead.
While the coronavirus can leave us feeling isolated and alone, it's really guilt that imprisons us and creates distance from God, family, and friends. But God wants to free everyone from that guilt. In Ephesians 1, verse 7, it says, Christ sacrificed his life's blood to set us free, which means that our sins are now forgiven. Christ did this because God was so kind to us. This scripture says that we find freedom when we are forgiven. Then we can, in turn, forgive others. We're free to be open and talk about everything in our hearts and minds, and that is what brings us together.
And what is more exciting and fulfilling than coming together to help our friends to be free?
Let's pray. God, thank you for Jesus giving himself so that we could all be free from guilt and sin. Help us to be inspired every day to do whatever it takes to help our friends experience that freedom. We also pray that you will speed a vaccine and eradicate COVID-19. We pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Fantastic. Don't you like those Better Together communions? I do. Great job, Scott and Margo. Great job, Silicon Valley. Now, I think we got a little something different for you for contribution. Take a look.
As we take up our contribution this morning, we want you to know that your generous and consistent giving is not only greatly appreciated, but is providing support for this weekly live stream that is serving people throughout the Bay Area in all 50 states and 110 countries. And as a reminder, on August 30th, we will be taking up our annual special contribution that will, among other things, help us expand our digital footprint and our digital content. Our special contribution goal this year is 7 times our normal weekly contribution.
Thanks for joining us today. If you're new to our Sunday live streams or need a quick reminder, there are 3 ways to give. Number one, PayPal Giving Fund. There are no credit card fees for PayPal Giving Fund, or by credit card, or by mail, which includes online bill pay. Go to bacc.cc/give for more instructions. See you next week, and thanks for your giving.
I hope you did your little dances. I know a lot of you danced to it. I hope you enjoyed that. See how we kept the music? That's our soundtrack for the joy of giving. Now, we've got a Sunday morning jetpack. Take a look.
Hey guys, this is Sunday Morning Jetpack. And so we've been talking lately about the importance of building our own convictions.
So think about this for yourself. How much of what you do is because of what other people tell you? How much of your time and energy is spent thinking about yourself and your own life?
You know, after reflecting on the idea of convictions, I've been realizing that a lot of my convictions come from other people around me. You know, when it comes to stepping up and making a real change, I fall short because I'm relying on someone else's beliefs and not my own. You know, I stop trying to make a real change in the world and settle for living for myself rather than seeking God's kingdom and who He's calling me to be.
In Matthew 6, verse 33, it says, "But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." So maybe you've heard the scripture before, especially if you're someone who grew up going to church. I know I can read the scripture and think I am seeking the kingdom. I go to church, I read the Bible, I pray, maybe I join a few Bible studies, but I've had to learn that seeking the kingdom and His righteousness first is so much more than just showing up. It's about changing who we are on the inside, wanting to be known and influenced so we can become who God is calling us to be. I don't have that wholehearted belief and conviction that God is going to give me everything I need, so I put myself and what I want above all else instead.
You know what it's like to want to put myself and what I want first? The last midweek service before the shelter in place, I didn't want to go at all. I wanted to stay home, watch a movie, put on a face mask, and chill by myself. I begrudgingly went and saw my friend Kiana. My first thought was, dang it, now I can't dip right after the lesson, because I knew that I should probably talk to her. I was planning in my head how to keep the conversation short and superficial so that I could still do my solo movie night. But once I started talking to her,
Sophia, hold on. I'm really happy for you. I'm gonna let you finish, but first let me show you this song. It really applies to what we're talking about. It's called Show Love by Everything Is Recorded. And they say, "Swear I feel it everywhere, so much ego in the air. If I die before I wake, then I hope I made a change. I know what my purpose was, show love, show love. You've grown up to show love. There's no love unless you own up." So like the song says, I think there's a lot of ego in the air. And I think that our generation, college and high school students, can have way too much ego. We put so much importance into the way we think, what progresses our lives, or just what we feel. And like many of us, for me, I think if I could just get a good job, or if I just get into a good school, or get a girlfriend, then I'll be happy. But none of those things will really make us happy, because there's always going to be something more that we'll want.
It's good that you talk about ego, because it was really humbling talking to Kiana. She ended up really opening up about her loneliness and how numb she felt. I realized that here was someone who was searching for answers, and I was about to leave early just so I could have a night to myself. I told her that building a relationship with God would help her understand why she felt that way, how to actually build a relationship she really wanted. We studied the Bible over the past few months, and she actually got baptized last week. I've had to fight for the conviction to keep putting God first and loving others, even when I want to be selfish in the moment.
So what we all really want is to live out our purpose, and we have to own up and grow up in order to show love to the people around us. We have to take the initiative to step up in our relationship with God, to give us the courage to really love others.
And that is your Sunday Morning Jet Pack. Check out the music section on deepspirituality.net for a Spotify playlist that has all of the Sunday Morning Jet Pack songs that we talked about so far. We'll see you guys next week.
Sunday Morning Jet Pack. Mic drop. Awesome. Guess what? We're going to be having a very special podcast Sunday coming up. It'll be coming up on August 23rd at 11 a.m., but it's going to be different. You'll watch, listen, but discuss. And it'll be a lesson that we're going to talk about, a message we're going to talk about, fear and anxiety. I think that's good. You've been feeling fearful? I have. Anxious? I have. Let's go to God and deal with those things. So make sure you make a note. And if you come to the live stream, make sure, and you're not part of one of our house churches, make sure you go to BACC Live, go to the website and figure out how you can get connected with one, because it'll be a shorter service and it'll be designed that you'll have tools to be able to have great conversations, because I think we need a little bit more fellowship together, just like communion said, so we can be better together. You know, one of the cool things that we do are the Freedom Flows. And I think we have a special Freedom Flows for you. It's combining a couple of things. One, we talked today about Ralph Waldo Emerson saying that history is best described as a time of illumination where people's lives change. We covered that today, how to change a life. And I think that that should be encouraging to you. And I hope that many of us will sit there today and ask the question, how can I become a story that God can tell through my life and then make an impact like so many of the people we saw? And thank you to everybody who took the time to share their story and to share their life. It has inspired all of us today. But there's a song that also tells a tale. Years ago, and I won't go into detail, so I'll make it brief, the Beatles, this is before I think I was alive, the Beatles were performing at a huge venue in the South. And it was segregated, black and white. The South was, and very strictly. When the Beatles went to perform, they found out when they got there, of course, remember the Beatles from England, they found out that only whites would be allowed to hear the concert and not blacks. They said, we won't perform then. And as a result, they integrated it. One of the women who shares in a documentary about the Beatles talks about the fact that she was sitting there amongst white people, black, for the first time in her life with them, able to watch the Beatles, and how much it changed her life. There are many different descriptions of a song called Blackbird. Some about a bird that was in India, that's part true. Some that have said it's about a grandparent of one of them, either McCartney or Lennon or something. But what Paul McCartney said in 2018 is that Blackbird should be interpreted as black girl in the context of the civil rights movement. And if you think about it that way, it makes you wonder, was it the black girl who got into that concert and sat amongst white people for the first time in her life and heard the Beatles sing? Well, same bad time, same bad place, same bad channel, and here you go, Blackbird, to reflect on how lives can be changed by all kinds of things, all kinds of stories. Thank you, Beatles, for that story. Here we go.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arrive. Blackbird singing in the dead of night.
Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to be free.
Blackbird, fly. Blackbird, fly. Into the light of a dark black night.
Little light of mine, I'm
light of a dark black night.
Moment to arrive.